check, mic check, mic check. You're now tuned in with Mike J. You know the host that do the most, I feel when you got a rapper from the West Coast on the intro. So smooth. Now we can play the instrumental. Blacktop, blacktop, blacktop radio. Where you can come and get your fix. We be talking about your baby mamas or some politics. First station out where you can tune in, hear the hottest shh. Ain't no filters, you hear all of it. You ain't really popping yet if you ain't never been a guest. Wait, let me guess, you got on next. Got the airwaves on flex. Boom. Blacktop, what did you expect? Blacktop radio.
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 Radio. Blacktop radio.
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 Blacktop. Blacktop.
Why I hated being biracial and how I overcame self-destruction. It was real for why I hated being biracial and why I hated black women in particular, because of how I was mistreated the most by black women. It's a legitimate, it's a mental thing. That is their truth. Whether you like it or not, that's their truth. Because I just said a whole bunch of stuff that I'm positive black people ain't gonna like.
We have our special guest on the line right now, ladies and gentlemen. Caller, hello. How you doing? This is Miss Ebony Acton.
Yes, it is.
How you doing today?
You know, a lot of emotions. However, I'm still great, honestly and truly.
Word. Well, first off and foremost, welcome to the show. We do appreciate you taking time out tonight to talk to us here tonight. So, you know, I was just giving them a backdrop of how I found you and asked you and invited you to the show. Pretty much, you know, I was telling that I got on Facebook a couple days ago and I saw a lot of people that were upset on my timeline. And one of the statuses that stuck out to me was one of my homeboys, and he said, how could she do this? You know, she went to HBCU. She was Miss VSU. And I'm lost. And I'm like, hold on. What's going on here? So I went on his status. And I pretty much asked what was going on. And he gave me your name. And so that's when I went and followed you and watched the video that you had posted on Instagram Live. Afterwards, after watching the first part, I said, you know what? I got to reach out and get on the show, because I think we all wanted to just get some clarity into the overall message of that Instagram video, the purpose, you know, what the timing, all of that. So I'll just first off ask you, you know, because people are hearing your voice for the very first time here on the Blacktop, your name, where you from, and, you know, of course, I've already leaked it to him that you a proud Trojan. But, you know, what you do as of right now.
So, I am Ebony Acton. I'm from Annapolis, Maryland, and I have many hats, especially, like, being a counselor for business, private businesses, and help them consult and revamp their businesses for better insight. But my main, you know, focus is
speaking. Word. Okay. Well, shout out to you. And, you know, you went to Virginia State University, proud graduate, Miss VSU. So I got to say congratulations to that as well.
Thank you.
So let's hop right into it.
Okay. Let's get into it.
So the video. For those who don't know, who haven't saw the video, I'm going to let you say the overall purpose of this video, but what was this video supposed to be about, and what motivated you to do it?
So, as the title was, Why I Hate Being Biracial and How I Overcame Self-Destruction, literally focuses on the raw, vulnerable, monstrous side of who I used to be. So when I was speaking out and sharing what I've experienced from my perspective, especially before I, you know, sought in substitute therapy for 1 year, which is last year, I was literally taking bits and pieces from my journals and realizing how narcissistic I've been for a really long time, how much I've avoided trauma recovery, and you know, of stayed in deception. And it was weighing in on me, especially when I was doing a lot of self-reflection last year, mainly, like I said, in therapy. And I wanted to give people like a public apology. And it's multidimensional, honestly and truly. It's more allegorical more than anything. I do not do this for clout, honestly and truly. I'm a devout person to my faith, and it's very bigger than me. Like I said, if it was for me, I'd be extremely, extremely quiet. Mm-hmm. However, there's a large mystery behind the assignment I've been given. Mm-hmm. And I've been chosen, I guess, for others to see, you know, public display.
Hmm. Okay. So, in watching the video and seeing the reactions from the video, because there were people who were all over my timeline, Twitter too, who was saying that you pretty much timed it wrong. As far as the sensitivity amongst the black people at this current moment, knowing what we're going through as a community, and to hear you know, these stories of you once hating black women, you said you would, you know, you once disliked black men, what you were going through, just seeing those responses, what, how did it affect you?
Well, seeing the responses, it definitely allowed me to sit back and realize that I definitely needed the change that I needed, and I have it. So I was actually very receptive to all the comments. And when I say like receptive, I took a hard look once more at myself, and, you know, really decided I don't ever want to be who I used to be. Because it was damaging, and not even was it damaging to myself, but it literally affected so many other people. And I neglected my position of having a voice and having an influence and being a leader. And it, like I said, it weighed in on me heavy to know I was living in deception for a really long time. And once again, not to be repetitive or to be redundant, but I really wanted to make sure that people got a public apology, because what I believe in is accepting all of you. That is something I stand firm in. But how can I literally preach something that I really wasn't practicing, you know? And I find that to be very hypocritical. And I don't want anything to hold on to me. So it could be leverage over my head, but literally live in freedom in the most raw, vulnerable way as much as possible.
Okay.
And I couldn't agree
anymore. I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
So I watched your video, and I'm just curious to know, you, in the beginning of the video, you stated that you had this issue from your family from 4 or 5 years old, and you had this feeling about black women, or how they never discussed race with you as you were younger. Your white side of the family never discussed race with you when you were younger. But if that was the case, what would make you go to an HBCU around nothing but black women and black men?
So I really felt, well, when I went to therapy, my therapist helped me realize one aspect was me trying to overcompensate for the voids that I had. Definitely sisterhood was one of the aspects, trying to prove myself and prove to others that I can be seen and sought as a black woman. And, you know, just literally ignoring the trauma that I should have talked about, that I should have thought, that I should have asked my mom if we can go to counseling. And I just never did. So I pushed forward to get more accolades and get more achievements so I could be accepted by black women. However, the narrative, the false narrative that was playing in my mind was, I hate black women. And that wasn't the case, because I was brought up by a beautiful, loving black mom. Watching The Imitation of Life, that literally helped me realize how much I do love my mom. And it was just a mess in my mind. And like I said, to me, this is freeing, not just for myself, but others, and allowing myself to be in a position of public reconciliation.
So did you hate yourself too?
At one point in time, I absolutely did. I don't know if you heard the part where I was in Africa last year. I had an opportunity to go to Zambia, Africa. And that was my ultimate last time of hating myself and realizing that I can't change who I want to be. Because being in Africa, I loved it. It was amazing. And I felt so out of place not being a Black woman. And I was just like something has to give. And what had to give was my false narrative, and to develop the strength to tell it whenever the time was appropriate to tell it, according to the Most High.
So being that, and I'm sorry, this is Raquel. Being that, I mean, VSU is 99% Black. And then you go to Africa, right, and that's like 99% Black. Well, like, I guess, was it just the age of maturity, or what shifted, or was it because they really didn't have what we have here in the States, or what was the, like, how did that be the turning point and not going off to college?
I'm sorry, can you finish your question? I'm so sorry.
No, you're fine. Good.
Oh. Okay. So I think that what really gave me that paradigm shift was, there's something magical about Africa. You really see a lot of things for what you took for granted. And being so that I was there on a missions trip, I was like deep in concentration, just very vulnerable and susceptible to what the Holy Spirit was telling me. And it was the fact that someone who has an African name, actually, or the Zambian name of being beautiful, he was a minister. He walked up to me and he said, "The Lord made you beautiful, so start accepting for who you are." And I was wrecked. I was wrecked because I just realized how long, like decades of how unhealed I was, and how much there is a necessity of healing within our Black community and all across the globe. So using my story as just, you know, a footstep, you know, and to make sure it's symbolic and it's, like I said, allegorical to its multi-dimension of its purpose.
So I do have another question. This is Milan. When you originally put out that video, was your intention to put out an apology after that, or did it come after?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I don't do anything without calculation. Yes, because that's the best word to use, without calculation. So the prayer that I used that morning was very personal because of the agony I was feeling to put myself out there publicly, and to know what was to lie ahead, especially the backlash. And it hurt. It really hurt to see the way I needed to see how much I've taken for granted the blessings that I've had in my life, especially with my Black family, my Black community, and loving me more for, you know, my Blackness. Well, actually, I always loved my Black side, honestly and truly. But like I said, that was a false narrative I was creating in my mind. And I just wanted to make sure, you know, people knew that they deserve a public apology, because there's just so many people that I've come across that they need to know what side I used to have and what side I want to be from here on forward. And that's just what I've been called and assigned to do. So yeah.
I was about okay. to ask, like, so the personal impact of this video,
Mike, hold on, Mike. So being that you said this is calculated, and let me just reframe back to your question, Mike, because now I'm curious. Now, being that you said you're very calculated how you do things, did you calculate on the time frame that you were going to put this video out? Did you feel like that this time frame was the perfect time for you to put this video out versus everything that's going on in the world, to create a different narrative than to turn around and apologize?
So with the timing, like I said, I can't agree more that the timing was horrible. And I, like I said, I'm truly apologetic to the sensitivity of the time. But I can't help but to say that I have to be obedient. And a lot
so are you not affected by everything that's going on and that has gone on? Like everybody that has died because of injustice killing, that has never affected you? Or did you just
absolutely. So what triggered this for the move to be obedient was all of a sudden my heart didn't move at the mention of racism on Wednesday on the 27th last week. And it bothered me entirely. So I was praying and I was just like, you know, Lord, why am I not moved by the racism? Because I was upset about Breonna Taylor. I was upset about, you know, the white men who chased down Ahmaud. And that was, you know, in the same month. So I'm really curious, like, why wasn't my heart moving? And I guess I was praying, and that's when God was just like, this is the time for you to move right now. And I couldn't agree anymore that the timing is absolutely horrible.
Hey, Carly, you on the Blacktop. Who's this?
Yeah, you know who it is. Goddamn, Bruce's money man.
Okay, what kind of question you got, big dog?
What's old girl name?
Miss Ebony Acton is on the line with us.
Yeah. Hi. First of all, how you doing?
I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm alright. About to go get this Mexican food real quick.
First of all, this ain't no coffee and conversation.
But yeah, I just got a question. My first question is, do you like black people or do you not?
No, I love black people. I love, like I said, that apology was very genuine, very sincere, that they deserve that apology more than, you know, my white counterparts, because that's where the majority of my apology is focused on, to share that I love them enough to give myself a public humiliation.
Okay. Because I was utterly shocked and confused by the whole goddamn state. And I don't even know if I could cuss on here, but I apologize if I ain't.
You just can't say the N-word. You all right?
Oh, all right, bet. We good. But yeah, I was just confused because it's like, I won't confuse at first. And then they said you was Miss VSU, and that joint just threw me off a little bit. I'm like, I know she ain't said that and went to that school.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I understand the apology, but I still don't understand, you know what I'm saying, how it was said in the beginning.
So how it was said was to be extremely raw, very vulnerable in a time where I was not all the way whole and where I was not healed. Like I said, to let people really see a side of me that I never showed. I never showed that side, obviously, because if I ever did, you know, I definitely would have got the backlash that I received now. So I'm not sad. I'm not angry. I'm not upset that people are very confused, that they want answers and stuff like that. And that's where I'm opening myself and allowing myself to be open to have more discussion about to get better with my identity.
Okay. Yeah, I just, like I said, I was just confused. And I don't know if you've seen what I said, but I said some shit that I probably shouldn't have said, and I'm going to apologize to you for what I said.
I'm not mad at you. I promise you I'm not. I'm not for sure all what right, you cool, have cool, said. Cool. Like I said, I've heard it all. But I genuinely, I'm not mad at anybody. I'm not.
All right, cool.
We appreciate you. All right,
Mike.
So you're all right,
who else on the show with you, Mike?
Milan and Brickale.
Hey!
Shout out to y'all. What is it?
We appreciate you asking that question, brother. We thank you.
Yeah, all right, thank you for that.
Big love to all y'all, man. Y'all be safe out here.
All right.
You too.
How do you move forward from this?
How do I move forward from this has everything to do with making sure people especially like right now in this high racial tension with those who are in mainly like biracial persons, that they understand the importance of knowing their identity and not feeling like they have to give this deception. Letting you know, the Black community know that they love them. I know I love my Blackness, honestly and truly. Like, my hair color and my hair texture is A1 because I am half Black, because at the end of the day, I got the physique that I have and it's natural. I never got any type of injections like a lot of the celebrities out here. Nope, that comes straight from my Black mama. And my lips, like, all of my features are beautiful because I am, you know, half Black and I come from a Black woman, and that's something I want to be more proud about. However, not being deceived for the false narrative that I had, you know, in my mind for a really long time. And I was wondering and hoping moving forward that we can, or I can get help to move that mental health awareness and getting mental health insurance, if that's even possible, for each and every state and district, that people like me, kids like me, that they get the help that they really need to love themselves a lot more.
Gotcha. So you see yourself more of an advocate role for mental health awareness.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Well, you know, I like I said, I wanted to bring you on because I think we all were just so caught up in wow, you know, this was something we didn't ever, you know, expect, you know, especially coming from someone who came from, you know, who pretty much supports Black, you know, when you think of.
Yes, because I do. I honestly, truly do. And that was the false narrative that I had in my mind. And like I said, no one deserves to not know that deception.
Word. Any personal people, like any family that reached out to you, any you know, I don't know if you have kids or not, but like anybody personal reach out to you and kind of was like, hold on for a second, or were they, you know, all for?
Oh, there was plenty of people. There was plenty of people that were like, what's going on? You know, talk to us. And it's really hard when you are devout to give. For you to have an assignment given to you that you don't tell other people, because like I said, I am a full Jesus believer. Mm-hmm. And I'm crazy enough to have the level of faith that I have, mm-hmm, to move when he tells me to move. And no matter what the backlash is, you know, I just have to move. I have to be obedient. But a lot of people did reach out to me. They were very loving. I got conversations with a lot of people that I haven't even spoke to years. Like, people from elementary reached out to me to let me know, like, I love you. Like, I never saw you for this. And that immense love has been, honestly, the barrier right now that I've been feeling. And like I said, not necessarily the hate, because I don't want to say that. The backlash that I received, that's why I keep saying the backlash that I received, has literally been a blessing for me. So I wasn't saying that in a very nasty, gloatful way. I was literally saying, like, this is showing me how much I have a voice, how much I have an influence, and how I can't take it for granted ever again.
Well, let me ask you a question, and this is Milan. Are you still getting counseling?
No, I do not get counseling anymore, only because I am true to what I believe. My counselor told me that if I were to continue therapy, I would create a codependency relationship with therapy to think that I always need it. And that would actually keep me stuck opposed to help me be more free. And she even gave me like my therapy for free as a gift, to let myself know that, you know, Black women do.
Was she legit?
At the end of the day. I'm sorry, what?
That's impressive. I was just asking, was she legitimate? Because I've never heard that.
She gave me therapy for free, and that's why I guess I owe it to a lot of people. I owe it to the world.
Yeah.
Well, I guess my last part of the question is, you went on Instagram and you apologized for all of your followers, as well as, you know, all of us here in the community. What's the feedback from that?
Did you do personal apologies aside from the public one, though? Because I know there were some people
I'm giving more of those, because I will be doing that. I have reached out to a lot of people, but I will be spending like the next 2 weeks just calling people, talking to people, and allowing people to see, you know, who I truly am.
Right. Okay. Well, I mean, like I said, I know people who go through traumatic issues and have a sense of, you know, post-traumatic stress from self-hate. You know what I'm saying? People getting bullied.
Yeah, it's real. It's real. And I want people to see how real it is and how it is showing and it's manifesting in his racism right now, because that's honestly and truly what it is. When a white man kills a black man, that's self-hate. And I'm getting tired of seeing it.
I want to say this as a black woman, though,
from
looking at your video, like, I can understand where you were coming from. At the same time, though, the timing is a little bit off, like I said, but also the fact that in your speaking in the videos, it does still feel like you're separating yourself from both races. And you kind of have like a mindset of you on your own. I know that you said your counselor may not have said that you needed more counseling, but I honestly think that would be a helpful thing, because it's not completely, it's not just a one and done situation. This has been happening to you since you were like 4 or 5, even younger. I think you continuously need to do that just for your own personal thing, to be more careful about certain things that are said, because yes, you have both sides, but you also have to be conscious of what you put out there, because it affects both sides.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree anymore, honestly and truly. And this is Milan, right?
Yes.
I was trying to pay attention to names and voices.
Yes.
And kind of to go to her codependency point, she might have said that, as far as maybe with her, because I mean, I can understand you being counseled by one particular person and you're so used to venting to them or getting advice from them, but maybe a change in perspective or change in person would restart or reset where you need to go. So I can agree with Milan.
I appreciate that.
Word. Well,
because I'm very receptive. I'm very receptive to everyone.
And I appreciate that. I do appreciate that.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think you definitely, shout out to your mental capacity. Because
exactly. Ooh, for even boy. Calling in and doing it.
Jesus. Oh, man. I mean,
Jesus Christ, honestly and truly.
I did see the last post you made, and you put up a picture of, you know, different shades of hands coming together, and you support that we all come together as humanity. Do you feel the need to stand on those front lines with us as far as protest?
Absolutely. There's no question about it. I'm bold enough to do it. I'm not afraid. I posted the video. I'm not afraid. I'm very bold, and I want to make sure that I'm using my voice for what it's meant to be.
Okay. Awesome.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Yeah. If you can,
I just need people to tell me what to do. Well, not saying what to do, but where to meet up, what to put out there and stuff like that. And as long as, you know, it's of great content, I'm gonna use my voice for greatness.
Okay. Well, just keep in mind, we always appreciate an ally more than the enemy.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Absolutely. Definitely. Well,
I pray for your continued healing, because that's a lot.
Thank you. Thank you. I really appreciate that.
And is the video still up, or did you take the first video down?
I'll put the video back up. several of my friends like, please take it down. I was just like, okay, just to please, you know, my friends, to bring it back up. And I hope that, you know, this particular interview, and I will be on actually more platforms talking about this. It gives people that insight to look back, where I was, And, you know, actually see the journey that I am continuing.
Do you date black or white?
I actually prefer to date black men, and the only reason why that has been is because I always wanted to be more accepted by them because of my story. And you know, it's difficult, but I'm really attracted to black men. Like, my preference is, you know, Morris Chestnut, Idris Elba, you know, like, I like them chocolate, honestly and truly. I really do. It's just something about a chocolate man and be like, ooh, makes you shiver.
But do you have real love for black men? Because I lose some black
I do. I do have black okay. men. I have a real love for black men. That's why I had to apologize to them, especially for the promiscuity that I was having towards them, because it was never their fault. However, like, someone like R. Kelly, like, you know, in the back of their mind, they're using this this trauma to not heal from it, and they end up hurting people. Like, they really end up hurting people, and that's what I was doing. I was hurting and I was damaging black men, and I don't want to do that. Like, I don't want to be a part of that movement that hurts black men, whether it's sex, whether it's emotional, whether it's physical. Like, I take a stand and I'm not doing that anymore. Like, I want to praise them as much as they praise me. I get the most respect from black men. And, like, what do you have, do I look like?
Do you have children?
You know, no, I have my little brother, who I think is my son in my mind.
But quick question, Ebony, because I know you just recently said in another video, or was it the same video? I can't remember because I watched both of them. But that white men were telling you you were more beautiful.
That
so do you feel different
recently.
Towards them? Or do you still feel the same? Or
So it wasn't until more recently I started hearing I was beautiful by white men, because my dad never told me that. My dad was very, very much of an alcoholic growing up. I never heard my dad say he's appreciative of me, proud of me. I mean, he would write it in a card, and I had to really be very considerate of how he's not necessarily ready to heal from trauma. Me and my mom are, but he is not necessarily willing to go through that step, because we did family counseling like twice when I was younger, but I just never cooperated at all. I didn't participate. Like, if they asked a question and I didn't want to answer it, I wasn't answering it.
Like, if you want to heal, you definitely got to be willing. That's
I'm sorry.
True. If you want to heal, you have to be willing.
Oh, yes. So when I was younger, I was like stuck up. I was stuck up in my ways. Like, I was like, I'm not about to talk about it. I don't want to talk about it.
Yeah.
We can talk about what I want to talk about, which is like a movie or something else, but I'm not talking about it. I was very strong-willed.
Do you feel like this will like kind of, well, I ain't gonna say kind of, but do you feel like this would affect your dating life now moving forward? Like, kind of?
Most definitely.
Absolutely. No question about it. And I want to keep it that way to help me stay focused to what I need to be focused on, because I was getting distracted a lot with the infatuation of wanting to date and stuff like that. So
yeah.
Without the beckoning of, you know, some men coming my way, that helps a lot. And I'm, like I said, I'm not mad at them at all for it.
Word.
Honestly, sweetheart, like, dating is a no-go. You definitely got to discover yourself before you can even think to give anybody a piece of you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I can agree. Well, is there anything you would like to say to the people that's listening? Because we actually have a lot of VSU students who are tuned in to this show. Of course, we right next to home here. You know, folks who grew up in Petersburg who might have ran into you as well. I mean, is there anything you want to say right now to those people listening?
I will reiterate the fact that I'm very appreciative of my VSU family, and, you know, appreciative of you guys bringing me on here. Mm-hmm. So we are able to move as a legitimate unit and, you know, be advocates for one another. So I'm very appreciative of everyone who let me know that they saw me. And I'm not trying to get emotional. That they always saw me for who I didn't see myself for. So I'm very appreciative that people noticed me, because I know I had a really hard time of noticing myself and seeing myself, no matter how much others were telling me. So I'm very appreciative of each and every one of you. I forgive anyone who said anything negative, honestly and truly. And I'm very appreciative of those who stood up for me.
Word. All right. Well,
we definitely appreciate you coming on and telling your story. I may speak a little harsh, but we definitely have to understand exactly where you're coming from. So the fact that you put it on a public platform, we want to allow you to discuss it on a public platform. And I appreciate you having the courage to come on here and actually do that and answer all the questions that we have for you.
Absolutely. I'm willing to be, you know, I'm willing to be what I used to not be, which is open.
Yeah, growth is necessary. And I have my hats off to you, so.
Thank you.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is Miss Ebony Acton. Again, I thank you so much for taking time out of your night to come and talk to us here. We appreciate the amount of bravery for you to call in here tonight and to bare your soul. And we appreciate you.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
I feel like
that's a heavy, that's a lot of...
I got the devil and the angel on both shoulders. You already know I'm a mental health psych major.
Yeah.
So I got that on one shoulder, but then I got this angry black girl on another shoulder. So I can't really... I said what I had to say while she was on the phone. And I don't know what else to say.
Okay. Brickell, you got anything to say?
It sounds like some deep rooted, very deep, 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 deep rooted stuff. And I know I think everybody has some level of deep rootedness, but I think in order to overcome and grow from and heal from,
right?
Yeah, you got to start from somewhere. And maybe that was her starting point.
Yeah. Which is very true. Everybody's journey is different.
Yeah.
But you have to understand when you put yourself, again, when you put yourself on a public platform,
the timing is
important.
Yeah.
Two, what you're putting out there is also important, but it low-key makes me feel like this is like some type of, it's a game almost. And I don't want to say it's a game to her, because I understood what she was saying, but the fact that you said everything you do is calculated,
that speaks volumes.
That kind of like threw me for a loop.
That kind of just...
That speaks... Yes. Because it's
like... So you calculated putting this out at this time for attention. Yeah. Did you calculate this apology as well? Because is this really an authentic apology to the people that you looked down at as you were coming up?
Yeah. Was this just a social media stunt? Because it's calculated is a very weighted word.
We've seen 6ix9ine do this shit every day. Yeah. So it's like, I don't know how to feel about it. Like, I understand that you probably need the healing and it's probably a journey for you. I get it, baby girl.
Yeah.
But your timing and the way you kind of articulated that just kind of makes me feel a little kind of slighted still. Yeah. And I like to give people the benefit of the doubt. So in my mind, on this shoulder, I'm giving her the benefit of the doubt.
Yeah.
But on this shoulder, I'm looking at her sideways.
So,
Mike, what you think?
I definitely agree the timing was horrible. We're already sensitive as a community as we speak. We need as much people banding together. We need as much people coming together as possible. I mean, granted, what happened to her, none of us can change that. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
None of us at the same time.
The shit she's been through.
None of us can really just, I mean, it just, I get what people may have got out of that, that she took the spotlight off of the real issue and put it directly on,
made it personal.
I always am an advocate for people speaking their truth. I'm always an advocate for people telling their stories, but it's just not the right time to do so. Because at this point, we don't really want to hear someone say, I hated black women, I hated black men, I hated, you know, saying the
our narrative is already effed up.
Yeah. I think that gave the white side more ammunition. Almost, you know what I'm saying? Because now, I mean, there's gonna be white people that may have listened to that video and say,
and the fact that you're a little bit of both,
yeah,
makes it look even worse on this side.
Yeah,
without you fully getting to know these people, with you coming into a situation with a preconceived notion from things that your family members did.
Yeah,
that's not fair to us.
It's not, even for, you know, approaching men. And you know, approaching black men, you know,
it's
that's
not fair.
That's one thing that we'll be right. Like, this ain't my type of party right here. Because I mean, we don't want to. I definitely think, listen, y'all, get some help. Mental health is real, because it's not fair.
And it's okay to get it. I think our community has a notion of, oh, you don't need no psychologist or no mental help. No, it's okay.
No. To
get it. It's okay to go get it. And if one counselor don't work on me, it won't work in general. Go to somebody else until you can get the healing and the progress that you need. It's efficient. It's effective.
Now,
go get it. But
I will say
honestly,
this.
If she feels like this is her timing, who are we to put anything?
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, this may be the timing where she can take heed to everything that's being said, and it actually makes sense to her.
Yeah.
So who are we to say you have to get treatment or counseling or whatever on our time? It's whenever it's best effective to you.
Yeah,
I think,
and this may be her treatment. The fact of the hard
exactly
from random people, that may be yes, yep.
Shout out to
shout out to
D Taylor. He says some truths don't need to be heard. Listen, y'all. I just
say that, but you know. Okay.
I honestly have a sister who is the same skin color as her. I have a mom who is the same skin color as her. Very light skin. Right. Very light skin. But they have still stood by the love and heart more on the love that they receive more than the hate. You can't give that hate any type of attention. That's number one. Number two, that's not everybody. I get it. Some people have really, you know, traumatized your way of thinking, but that's not every single black person on this earth.
And no.
I really had that in my head as I was sitting here listening to her, because there are some very outstanding black young brothers and sisters out here. You know, there are some very uplifting young black brothers and sisters. There are some very intellectual and respectful young black brothers and sisters. And I think at a time where white people already think we dumb, we stupid, we trouble, we stink, we all that, I just think the message that she gave kind of gave those white people a little bit of ammunition to try to use against us to say, oh, okay, well, shit, y'all black people ain't no better. You out here, you know, molesting kids. You out here, you know, at this point in time, we need you on these front lines. We need you out here fighting with us.
We need her to be comfortable with who she is.
That's most important.
We don't need her to pick a side. We need her to feel comfortable with both sides.
With who she is.
Both people.
Exactly.
But you know what, though?
Right, and not have hate. Yeah.
That's the most important part. But I think what's even crazier is that when she put money on it, if she got pulled over today, they would look at her as a black woman, no matter what. The way they treat women that look like her, they would treat her as such. And I would hate for her something to happen to her by police, and this be the lasting message that she, you know, bear the truth that she hated us, that she this, you know what I'm saying? And granted, you know, at one point, you know, she apologized, and you know, definitely, you know, more power to you. But I would just hate for that to be a lasting impact on the Black community that you made at this point, to where we don't know how to feel if something happened to the hands of police brutality, because they don't care what you classify as light skin or dark skin. If they want it, they clearly they show they don't care who you are. As long as you're described as Black, they see you as a threat.
Yep.
So, I mean, I wanted to take this opportunity to just invite her on to not just speak and bring clarity to the video that she posted, but also let her know, you know, granted, you know, we need as much unity as possible at this point. We do not want to feel like that there's someone on our side who pretty much sees what we're going through and maybe thinking a different mindset.
But also, we don't want fake unity. We want it to be real. That's we don't want you to say it just to be a part of the crowd. Yeah. We want it to be legit. Less legit how you feel.
That's very true. I'm interested to see how the Christian community gonna feel about this. Because now that she has an apology out there, mind you this, you know, she prayed before she spoke in the first video. And she said that God, you know, gave her the green light to speak about these things. But now it's an apology. And I just see that, you know, if God told you to spoke about that, you know, are you standing in your truth, or are you just apologizing to so that we don't backlash you anymore? You know what I'm saying? That's a question for, you know, a later day. But nonetheless,
maybe she needed more clarity before proceeding with her action.
And I respect that. I respect it. But nonetheless, listen, we are open these doors to any and everybody, whether they have the right message or the wrong message. But just know, the energy you put out there, is the energy you receive. So it's just good, and I give her much respect. She took every ounce of criticism on the chin. Mm-hmm. So
I appreciate that, though. I do appreciate that. She got tough skin.
Yeah, definitely. If you are tired of living check to check, owe the IRS and need a refund, need a tax preparer who will represent you, look no further. Contact Journal Audits today. Our mission is helping clients to build economical stability. We service individuals, self-employed, and small businesses. Let's help you change your financial situation today. Visit journalaudits.com or call us at 804-893-5007. Again, that's 804-893-5007 to schedule your appointment today. Journal Audits, proud sponsor of the wildest radio show on the net, The Blacktop. Thank you so much for watching our video. Now, if you don't mind, can you do us one more favor? Hit that subscribe button and also tap that bell notification. That way you're alerted about all of our live content, our live episodes, behind the scenes information, also live interviews with some of your favorite guests, and plus many more right here on Blacktop TV. Also, if you need more information about the show, follow us on Instagram, The Blacktop. That's DABLACKTOP, and you know me. Ha! I'm a poet, ain't even know it. I rhyme all the time, and that's about it.